Hello everyone, I'm Michael Rubano of the Chicago Audio Collective, showing you another demonstration video of another amp restoration. Here we have, in a number of pieces, a Harmony Model 200 that I estimate to be from about 1950. I've partially disassembled the cabinet and disassembled everything else to show you the component parts and what we will do to get it up and running. This is the original cabinet. It's covered in a material called airplane cloth, which is a kind of canvas that has a paint-like coating, and it looks like the original owner actually painted over that, so it has a very thick kind of covering. The speaker was mounted here, and in front of it was this grill, kind of like a picture frame, and directly in front of the speaker is a wire frame that's flocked with the Harmony trademark, and it looks like it's got quite a bit of paint over it, so much of it is hard to see. But that's originally how the amplifier was made up. And the circuit sat on this shelf facing backward so that the controls and the cord and all the connections faced backward, because in that time the amplifier would have been placed on the front of the stage, not at the back of the stage. That's pretty familiar nowadays. So, like I said, it has a back-facing chassis. It originally had three inputs, and a fourth one was added by the owner. This is the AC cord. It has two channels. One indicates microphone or instrument. The other one indicates just instrument, and in those days it could have been anything. Certainly an electric guitar, a pedal guitar, perhaps an accordion, and a tone control here, a relatively simple one that also includes the on and off switch. The interior of the amplifier is pretty conventional for that era. It's completely hand-wired. It has a lot of its original components and resistors and wiring. So what we're going to do is go through each one of these components one by one. We're going to look at the resistors, measure them to see if they are on value, replace any that have drifted off value, which is rather common for a piece of electronic equipment this old. We'll also replace all of these capacitors. They're made of organic materials, things like paper and cardboard and tar and wax, and these things don't age very well. And since this amplifier is over 60 years of age, they're not going to work, so we're just going to replace them all. It looks as though some work has been done. I can see that this is not the original power transformer because it doesn't fit in the original space. There are some holes that are not filled by bolts holding the transformer in place. So that tells me at some point it was replaced with this component here. This is a combination of capacitors in a metal can. It was commonly used in radios and record players and guitar amplifiers. It's quite a bit loose, and it has a paper label, which lends me to believe that it was replaced. And I can also tell that underneath there's some fresh wiring. So we may want to replace that. It looks pretty old, and it's unlikely that it's going to work properly. Another interesting part of this amplifier is its speaker. Now, the cone looks like it's in pretty good shape, and I don't feel that there's anything caught in the gap. But you will notice that it has its power transformer riveted to the frame, and that was very common in those days. Like the Gibson that we looked at in another video, it was very common for the supplier to source the transformer, install it, and then put the rest of the speaker together. But what's even more interesting about the speaker is its magnet design. And you may be able to see that there are some wires running into a coil that's wrapped in paper here where the magnet should be. This is what's referred to as an electromagnetic speaker. At the time this amplifier was made, that principle was a little bit obsolete, but nonetheless, it was probably used to save a bit of money and also to save space on the chassis. What an electromagnetic speaker does is, unlike this type of conventional speaker, which was made in the 60s, this has a conventional permanent magnet, and that's the word that's used to refer to this type of magnet that is not electromagnetic. It's simply a piece of magnetic material attached to the cone, and it sticks to any metal. That's how you can tell it's a permanent magnetic speaker, and it sticks pretty well. This does not do that. This requires an electric current through this coil to create the magnetic field under which the speaker operates. And that current is provided by the power supply, and this inductor also serves as a portion of the power supply and helps remove some of the AC ripple that would result as hum. So, kind of unique. You don't see it very often in electric guitar amplifiers or any kind of electronic equipment after 1950 or so. When this amplifier is completed and all put together, it's going to have a very interesting sound because of its age. It predates rock and roll by many years. None of that kind of music was even thought of when this amplifier was put together. It was probably owned by someone who played country music or perhaps jazz. And once it's put back together, everything is safe, everything is operational, and we prepare to play test it. It's going to sound really great, I think. And that will be put on video and placed on the site at a later date. So hopefully we'll see you there.